morning. Our worship continues on page 355 in the Red Book of Common Prayer. Page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have built your church upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Grant us so to be joined together in unity of spirit by their teaching, that we may be made a holy temple acceptable to you through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated to hear the readings from Scripture.
So if you like a good Bible story, the second book of Kings has a big number of them. Today's lesson has it all. Two of the Bible's real rock stars, but you gotta keep them straight. Elijah and Elisha. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other, until the two of them crossed onto dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet before I am taken from you," Elisha said, no, that's where we, he responded, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could see no longer, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. He picked up the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. He took the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and struck the water, saying, "Where is the Lord, the God of Elijah?" When he had struck the water was parted to the one side and to the other, and Elijah went over. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So now we're going to read Psalm 77, and we're going to read it responsibly by half verse, and I think it's made pretty easy for you because the your half is in the bold print. I will cry aloud to God.
I will cry aloud, and he will hear me.
In the day of my trouble, I sought the Lord.
My hands stretched out by my neck,
and did not tire.
I refused to be comforted.
I will remember the works of the Lord.
And all time your wonders the whole time.
I will meditate on all your acts. Your way, O God, is holy.
Who is so great, God, as our God?
You are the God who works wonders
and have declared your power among the peoples.
By your strength, you have redeemed your people,
the children of Jacob and Joseph.
The waters saw you, O God. The waters saw you and trembled. The clouds poured out water and skies thundered.
Your arrows flashed to and fro.
The sound of your thunder was in the whirlwind.
Your
lightnings lit up the world.
The earth
trembled and shook. Your way was in the sea and your paths in the great waters.
Yet your footsteps were not seen.
You led your people like a flock.
By the hand of
Moses and Aaron. So the second reading is a reading from Paul's letter to the Galatians. For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love, become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now, the works of the flesh are obvious. Fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, dissensions, carousing, and things like these. I am warning you, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. Glory to you, Lord Christ. When the days drew near for Jesus to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers ahead of him. On their way, they entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him, but they did not receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem. When his disciples, James and John, saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them. Then they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me," but he said, "Lord, first let me go and bury my father." But Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at my home." Jesus said to him, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. Well, today in the second half of that gospel passage that we just heard, we find Jesus traveling from one village to another as he does often in his ministry. Along the road on which he's traveling, three different people engage him in conversation, and each of them tell him that they will or they want to follow him. But in the conversations that follow, we learn some interesting information and perspective. For example, in his words of response to the first man, Jesus intimates that the man doesn't really understand the full reality of what he's signing up for. Because following this itinerant preacher is a challenging life, one of regular ministry and service. So Jesus tells him that the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head, meaning that if this man truly follows him, his life will with Jesus will be one of action and travel, and he will be sent out to do God's work and probably won't be standing still or staying in place all too often. And then the next man with whom Jesus speaks is invited by Jesus to follow, but the man tells him he has something else to do first. He wants to go and bury his father. And again, Jesus has some interesting words and perspective for him too. He says, "Let the dead bury their own dead and just come and follow me." Then there's that third man who wants to follow Jesus on the way, but he wants Jesus to let him say goodbye to people at his home before he sets out to follow. And to this man, Jesus says, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." Now, Jesus' response to these men might seem a bit harsh, or at least that's how many of us might hear it. Maybe his words strike us as even critical or unfair, and some of us may say, "Come on, Jesus, let that poor man bury his dad. It's important family work. He's trying to fulfill his responsibilities, and he probably loved his father, and even if not, it's a duty to take care of one's parents, especially with their final arrangements." And with that third man, we may wonder why in the world Jesus wouldn't let him or want him to say goodbye to his own family before embarking on a life following God. He'll be leaving his family behind, so we might think that none of these words or reactions are very kind or seem very generous of Jesus. But while that may be so, maybe he's trying to make a deeper and an important point. Maybe he's trying to truly teach the men and teach all of us about what following God is really like and what it requires of us. Maybe following God isn't what we initially think, or even to be true from the outset. But maybe when we take those first steps, we realize that following God involves our heart and our soul and our mind and even our bodies, and involves more prioritization than we could have predicted, and more trust, but also more blessing than we could have imagined too. For example, as I was thinking about this gospel story this week and what it might be teaching us, I was reminded about the 12 steps in Alcoholics Anonymous. And I specifically reflected on the first three steps, which are that people in AA admit that they're powerless over alcohol, and because of that, their lives have become unmanageable. The second step is that they come to believe that a power greater than themselves can restore them to sanity. And the third is that they willingly decide to turn their lives, their will and their lives, over to the care of God as they understand God. And then the other nine steps have to do with admitting wrongdoings and making confession, seeking prayer, and serving others. But the first three steps are so important because in reality, living a healthy life, whether we're in a 12-step program or not, really requires that we put God first and surrender our lives to God before anything else that we do or any other steps that we take. I remember when I was in my early 20s, I made a bad decision. And when I tell you what it was, you might chuckle and say, really, that was it. But it had to do with choosing a church for my internship site during my second year in seminary. All second-year students at Virginia Seminary had, and I believe still have to be, participating in an internship at a local parish or maybe a school if they feel that they're called to chaplaincy or even a hospital. And the church that I chose was chosen out of anxiety, fear, and even peer pressure. It might seem silly, but the deadline for the students to make the decision was approaching, and many of my classmates already had been placed or chose their internship sites. And I was just anxious to choose mine too and check it off the list. I didn't want to seem strange for lagging behind my peers in this decision, or maybe even like a loser for not having a site yet. And so I settled on a church that was really fine, but when I look back on it, it was just not the church for me. When I made the decision, I felt in my gut that it just wasn't right. And inevitably, the decision led to a year of confusion and frustration and even more anxiety, because the rector even died suddenly during that year, and the associate rector was inhibited for ministry for anger and violence issues. I think he even like attacked somebody in the church. Anyway, maybe I perceived this going into it. So I realized that while the church was full of lovely people and they were participating in good ministry, I sort of felt that at the outset, something was just not right. God was actually not calling me there and was guiding me away from that community, but I wasn't listening. I wasn't putting God first or God's call or God's guidance first. I was just thinking about peer pressure and the calendar and anxiety before my relationship with God and before what God was trying to say to me. So while the dialogue of the story in today's gospel might seem overly dramatic, we know that when we don't put God before all other concerns, things in our lives, and maybe even our very life itself, can just fall into chaos. It's like that classic example of putting on our own oxygen mask before helping others with theirs. God is our oxygen, and if we don't have God's breath or follow God's breath, we perish, and those around us are at risk of perishing too. But when we put God first and listen to God and follow where God is leading us, everything else has the opportunity to fall into place. Lives that are unmanageable become manageable because we give God the space to actually manage them. And we have the opportunity to avoid a lot of pain and suffering in and along the way. So it's no coincidence that the 12 steps of AA begin with surrender to God. And similarly, it's no coincidence that the 10 commandments that were given to Moses and the people of Israel and to us begin with, I'm the Lord your God. And even colloquialisms like God, family, and country put God at the beginning of the list. Because when we put God first and do all things in service to God, then we fully receive the blessings of a life lived in God. So maybe the examples about following Christ in today's gospel are a bit dramatic, or maybe they're not. And maybe Jesus in the end did let the man bury his father and he let the other man say goodbye to his family, but we don't really know. If that happened, that part of the story wasn't recorded. But maybe the men and we are called to understand that following God requires our trust and a willingness to accept that we're not in control and that we should put God's call on our life as a priority. And this kind of mindset and this kind of life of trusting a power other than ourselves and relinquishing control to that power is quite countercultural. But a wise person once said that you can't truly rest until every area of your life rests in God. So maybe that's what following looks like. Maybe it's like rest and surrender to God. So as we look ahead to the summer that's stretched out ahead of us, where we have some time for a bit more rest and surrender anyway, and even if not, maybe we can find God in the process, we might practice a bit of surrender to God. Maybe we might put God first in a new way, or just let ourselves be with God, maybe on the beach or at the lake, in the woods or on a hammock, and see what comes up. Maybe God will draw you in and ask you to put God's call first. And then I invite you then to say yes and just take a few steps and see where the journey takes you. Amen. I invite us to rise as we are able and turn to page 358 in the prayer book, and we'll say the Nicene Creed together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate through the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. He is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people begin on page 385 of the prayer book. Looks like you're all standing. Please stand or kneel as you are able. I ask for your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for our presiding Bishop Michael, for our bishops Andrew, Alan, and Mary, Amanda, our rector, for this gathering, and for all ministers and people. Pray for the church. I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, for the well-being of all people, for grace to contend fearlessly against evil and to make no peace with oppression. May we continue to welcome and affirm all people of all orientations, identities, expressions, ethnicities, and help us to remember and celebrate all of us who are made in God's image. We pray for all who serve in the military, for Joseph, our president, and Kathy, our governor, and for the people of Ukraine. May God comfort and protect all those who fear for tomorrow, and may discernment and compassion guide the decisions of our world leaders. Pray for justice and peace. I ask for your prayers for the poor, the sick, the hungry, the oppressed, and those in prison, and for those on our parish prayer list, including Beth Cody Kimmel, Robert Dickey, Jack Sandlin, David Redden, Isabella Simano, Brian Nice, Henry Atkins, Victor Ruiz, Eddie O'Connell, Judy Dixon, David All, Joe Garofolo, Dee Dee Garofolo, Marilyn Jaffe Ruiz, Steve Lobel, Annie Rocco, Ron Madden, Kathy Madden, Chris Brown, Edwina Leahy, John Ruda, John Aldridge, John Osborne, Doug Logan, Carl and Jay Hill, Marcus, Terry, Jamie, and all those who suffer from gun violence. Pray for those in any need or trouble. I ask your prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of Him. Pray that they may find and be found by Him. I ask your prayers for the departed and for Ruth Webling Anderson, which most of you, many of you didn't know, but she was a wonderful person, Ruth Webling Anderson, in whose name our altar flowers have been given. Pray for those who have died. I ask your prayers for those celebrating birthdays or anniversaries this week, for the St. Philip's Nursery School, and all the blessings of this life. In the Episcopal Futures cycle of prayer, we pray for the congregations and congregants of the South Bronx Team Ministry. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for province of the Episcopal Church of Sudan. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day.
And using the form on page 360, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor, and I invite you to kneel as you are able. Page 360. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please rise as we share the peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Thanks so much. God's peace. So then you'll help me just do that. It's great to see everybody on this warm third Sunday after Pentecost. And as I said, at 8 o'clock, as the weather warms up outside, things kind of calm down this week into the summer at the church. So maybe a time of rest for you as some of us head out on vacation, maybe work and school slow down a little bit. But this is the first Sunday we don't have children's chapel. Our choir, I think, is going to continue to sing throughout the summer because we just started up in March, and why take another break? We might have a break in January instead of the summer. So let's hope that is not the case, but you never know. But summertime yoga continues on the lawn on Wednesdays, every Wednesday at 4 o'clock. So come find us on the rectory lawn, or like this week, it was kind of rainy, so we were inside. No one has joined us on Zoom yet, so I might give it another week and then just say it's in person only. But 4 o'clock Wednesdays. Vacation Church Camp returns this summer, August 8 through 12. So sign up anybody that you know that would like to participate. And St. Mary's up the street, St. Mary's Episcopal Church, is having a blood drive, it looks like, this Friday. So the details are in there if you can give blood. Thank you to everybody who volunteered for the midnight run. We had some of our own parishioners do that this week. It's bringing clothing and supplies to the homeless in New York, in the city. And the Presbyterian Church in town kind of coordinates churches in our area. So they brought food and clothing to the homeless last night. And also news that I'd like to share is that St. Philip's applied for two grants recently. One is called the First Steps Grant, and they're both from the Diocese of New York. And the First Steps Grant is a grant that seeks to grow the church, either spiritually or in number, through this grant. And churches were invited to apply for it about 2 months ago for a project or a ministry that they would like to start or complete or that's ongoing. And so we actually applied, and it's $5,000, and we received it for the permanent solution for our live streaming. So a lot of this over the last couple of years has been cobbled together by personal equipment and things that we've just put together, and it kind of takes up a lot of space. So we got news, I think, on Friday that we received the grant. So you'll see some changes up here, a new laptop, a new camera, probably something mounted that is more discreet. So we are very happy to have received that. And we also received a grant, and maybe Gabe can help me remember how much it's for. Is it 2,500 or 4,000? 4,000 for an environmental sustainability grant. And we applied to put in better storm windows, or even any storm windows, in the parish house to help with our heating costs over the summer. And we received $4,000 toward that. So that will be something that we see changes over the next few months to help with our heating costs in the winter. So lots of good news to share as we head into the summer and use our air conditioning. Anything else to share this morning? Coffee hour is down the hill today. So if you just head down the stone gravel steps, and coffee hour is outside the parish house. All are welcome. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us as an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
on page 372 in the prayer book. Page 372. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right to glorify you, Father, and to give you thanks, for you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light, inaccessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and fill them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day. And beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing. Acclaim you, Holy Lord, glorious in power. Your mighty works reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care, so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might rule and serve all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help, so that in seeking you, we might find you. Again and again, you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets, you taught us to hope for salvation. Father, you loved the world so much that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son to be our Savior. Incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, he lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners, freedom, to the sorrowful, joy. To fulfill your purpose, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the grave, destroyed death and made the whole creation new. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose for us, he sent the Holy Spirit, our own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world and to bring to fulfillment the sanctification of all. When the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Father, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and his descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting his coming in glory, and offering to you from the gifts that you have given us, this bread and this cup, we praise you and we bless you. We praise you, we bless you, we give thanks to you, and we pray to you, Lord our God. Lord, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, Lord, your one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. And grant that we may find our inheritance with all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. You may be seated. All are welcome to come forward to the altar rail at this time to receive communion or a blessing. If you'd like to receive the bread, just place your hands like this and you'll receive a wafer and you can eat it at that time. And then when the chalice comes to you, you may sip wine from the chalice. We're not intincting right now. We're not dipping the bread into the chalice because of increased or continued concerns about COVID. So if the chalice comes to you, please do not do that. Just drink or cross your arms over your chest and the words of administration will still be said to you. And if you'd like to come to the altar rail and just receive a blessing, you can cross your arms over your chest and instead of receiving the bread or the wine. All are welcome and gluten-free wafers are also available. Body of Christ. is on page 365. I invite us to kneel as you are able, and we'll pray together. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you today and remain with you forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Alleluia, alleluia, let us go forth in the name of Christ. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Did you get one of these last week? Thank you.